Everyone, myself Dr. Vatsala Agarwal, Head of Department at Deen Dayal Upadhyay Hospital, extend a very warm welcome to all of you, especially General Council Member Dr. Naveen Malhotra, President ISI Delhi Branch Dr. Nikki, Vice President Dr. Usha, Secretary ISI Delhi Dr. Umesh Deshmukh, Treasurer Dr. Anu Vijayan, and our editor Dr. Parul Malik. Gives me immense pleasure to host this scientific feast, which could be organized with a lot of grit and determination of my postgraduate students who have been in the forefront in managing COVID patients, and now they have taken up this task of actively participating in this scientific program also. The formalities of this program will be conducted by Dr. Ritu, who is also our executive member. Dr. Ritu.
I am Dr. Ritu Agarwal, and I welcome you all to this monthly meet at DDU Hospital. First and the foremost, I request all of you to please stand for the ISA flag hoisting ceremony. Thank you. We extend a very warm welcome to all the attendees. And also a very warm welcome to all the office bearers. Dr. Rajiv Gupta, sir, Governing Council Member, North ISA National. Our Dynamic President, Dr. Nikki Sabharwal, ma'am. Dr. G. Usha, ma'am, the Vice President, ISA Delhi. Dr. Umesh K. Deshmukh, sir, Secretary, ISA Delhi. Dr. Anu Vijayan Goyal, sir, Treasurer, ISA Delhi. And our very own Dr. Parul Malik, ma'am, Editor, ISA Delhi Branch. We also extend a warm welcome to all the GC members, Dr. Arvind Arya, GC East Zone, Dr. Arun Mehra, GC West Zone, Dr. Amit Kohli, GC Central Zone, Dr. Ashish Dang, GC North Zone, Dr. Ranju Gandhi, GC South Zone.
Now I would request Dr. Nikki ma'am to kindly address the meeting, please. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Ritu. Very, very good evening to one and all. Let me take this opportunity to wish you a very healthy, happy and prosperous new year. We have been through a very tough 2020 and we see some hope now with the cases coming down and the vaccines having been rolled out. So we hope that this year will be easier, healthier, happier, and we can meet socially as well. It is my pleasure to welcome you all to our first ISA monthly clinical meet of this year. And this is being very kindly hosted and organized by Deen Dayal Upadhyay Hospital under the able leadership of Dr. Vatsala Agarwal. I thank Dr. Vatsala and her team for overcoming all challenges which have been posed by this pandemic. And also a special thanks to her postgraduates who have come forward to participate in today's meeting. A great academic program has been put up for us, and we are eagerly looking forward to listening to you all. So thank you very much. Long live ISA, long live ISA Delhi. Jai Hind.
We start with the scientific session now.
Now I request our head of the department, Dr. Vatsala ma'am, to kindly host the scientific session. All the queries regarding the scientific session will be posted in the chat box and they will be addressed at the end of the program. Over to Dr. Vatsala.
Thank you, Dr. Ritu. Welcome to the scientific program. There are four sessions in our program today. Our first presentation is a comparative study to assess the depth of anesthesia with preoperative single dose of intravenous dexmedetomidine versus intravenous fentanyl using bispectral index in patients undergoing general anesthesia. It will be presented by my third year student, Dr. Archana, and second year student, Dr. Vaseem. Dr. Vaseem will be giving us the methodology of the study, and Dr. Archana will be discussing the result. Dr. Vaseem, please.
A very good evening, respected senior and my dear friends. I am Dr. Vaseem Ahmed, second year DIB in the Department of Anesthesia, Deen Dayal Upadhyay Hospital, Harinagar. The topic of my presentation is comparative study to assess the depth of anesthesia with preoperative single dose of intravenous dexmedetomidine versus intravenous fentanyl using bispectral index in patient undergoing general anesthesia. The result and discussion part will be presented by Dr. Archana Thapa, final year DNB. The moderator for our session is Dr. Vatsala Agarwal, HOD Anesthesiology. John L. introduced the concept of balance anesthesia in 1926. Balance anesthesia comprises of amnesia, analgesia, hypnosis, muscle relaxation, and obtundation of reflexes. Balance anesthesia allows us to minimize risk and maximize patient comfort and safety. The assessment of depth of anesthesia is crucial for safe anesthetic practice to prevent intraoperative awareness. Intraoperative awareness is unpleasant fear experienced by patient and it causes psychological harm to the patient. The bispectral index monitor is first method which is FDA approved to assess the depth of anesthesia. Fentanyl is a strong mu opioid receptor agonist which is typically 50 to 100 times more potent than morphine. It is a synthetic lipophilic phenylpiperidine opioid agonist with analgesic and anesthetic property. Fentanyl is used in the doses of 1 to 2 microgram per kg for provide analgesia. It is also used an adjuvant to inhale anesthetic in attempt to blunt circulatory response to direct laryngoscopy or sudden change in level of surgical stimulation in the doses of 2 to 20 microgram per kg IV. It is also used as an induction agent in cardiac anesthesia in doses of 10 to 20 microgram per kg IV. Dexmedetomidine is highly selective alpha 2 adrenoreceptor agonist. It is stereoisomer of medetomidine. It was introduced in United States in 1999. Dexmedetomidine is FDA approved for sedation in ICU patient with a loading dose of 1 microgram per kg transfused over 10 to 20 minutes to prevent sudden bradycardia and maintained with the dose of 0.2 to 0.7 microgram per kg per hour infusion. It is used for post anesthesia shivering in the doses of 0.5 microgram per kg infused over 3 to 5 minutes. It is also used as an adjuvant for regional anesthesia, but these uses are not FDA approved. BIS monitoring involves the application of four electrodes on patient's forehead. BIS monitor collects raw IEG data through its sensor and uses an algorithm to analyze and interpret the data. BIS value ranges from 0 to 100. As shown in figure, flatline EEG value corresponds to BIS value of 0 and 100 for awake patient. The target BIS value for general anesthesia is 40 to 60. The aim of our study is to assess the depth of anesthesia with preoperative single dose of intravenous dexmedetomidine versus intravenous fentanyl using bispectral index in patient undergoing elective surgery under general anesthesia. The primary objective was to observe the depth of anesthesia of IV dexmedetomidine in patient undergoing general anesthesia using BIS. To observe the depth of anesthesia of IV fentanyl in patient undergoing general anesthesia using BIS. To compare the depth of anesthesia of IV dexmedetomidine and IV fentanyl in patient undergoing general anesthesia using BIS. The secondary objective was to compare the following hemodynamic parameters like heart rate, systolic blood pressure, diastolic blood pressure, mean arterial pressure, and oxygen saturation. Approval was obtained from Institutional Ethical and Scientific Committee. A prospective randomized double-blind controlled trial study conducted in Deen Dayal Upadhyay Hospital with a sample size of 130. The sample size calculation was based on pilot study and observation by Goel et al. Randomization was done by computer-generated random numbers. 130 ASA grade 1 patients scheduled for elective surgery under general anesthesia were divided into two groups. Group D patient received intravenous infusion of dexmedetomidine in the doses of 0.6 microgram per kg in 50 ml of 0.9% saline. Group F patient received an intravenous infusion of fentanyl in the doses of 2 microgram per kg in 50 ml of 0.9% saline. All patients received a loading dose of study medication 10 minutes prior induction of anesthesia. Patients from both the gender, age between 18 to 70 years undergoing general anesthesia belonging to ASA grade 1 included in the study. While we excluded all the patients who were not willing to participate in the study, patients with an anticipated difficult airway, obese patient, patient having history of convulsion or allergy to study drug, patient with opioid dependency or history of alcohol or drug abuse, a cigarette to patient, pregnant patient, and lactating mother are also not included in the study. Proper written informed consent from all the patients were obtained in PAC was done. Then patient randomly assigned into two groups by using computer generated random numbers. On arrival in the operation theater, fasting status, consent, PSA were checked. All standard monitor attached to the patient and baseline reading were noted. Intravenous access taken, a Ringle is rated started with a dose of 2 ml per kg per hour. The study drug was administered over 10 minutes using syringe pump 10 minutes prior to the induction of anesthesia. In both the group, patient received IV glycopyrrolate, IV ondansetron syndrome, and induction of anesthesia was done by using propofol in the dose of 2 mg per kg, titrated till lost the response to verbal command obtained and BIS value noted. IV vecuronium bromide in the dose of 0.1 mg per kg given for neuromuscular blockage. Then patient manually ventilated with oxygen for 3 minutes till complete relaxation. Direct laryngoscopy was performed and endotracheal intubation done with appropriate size endotracheal tube. Heart rate, systolic blood pressure, diastolic blood pressure, mean arterial pressure, BIS value and SpO2 value were noted. Anesthesia was maintained with 60% nitrous oxide and 40% oxygen and titrated MAC value of isoflurane. Maintenance of neuromuscular blockage was done with 0.01 mg per kg intermittent dose of vecuronium bromide. After completion of surgery, the inhaled anesthetic was discontinued. Inpatients were kept on 100% oxygen. The residual neuromuscular blockage was reversed with IV neostigmine and IV glycopyrrolate. Once the patient regained consciousness and fulfilled the criteria of extubation, the endotracheal tube was removed after gentle suctioning and deflating the cuff. After checking the postoperative vital, patient was shifted to postoperative ward. The following parameters were recorded as outcome of interest: heart rate, non-invasive blood pressure, oxygen saturation, and BIS value. These parameters were recorded at the following time: during the administration of study drug at 0, 5, 10 minutes, on shifting the patient to OT, on induction of anesthesia, before laryngoscopy, after intubation, thereafter every 5 minutes for half an hour, 10 minutes for next half an hour, every 15 minutes till the end of surgery, any episode of apnea also recorded. The comparison of continuous variable between the groups were performed using student t-test. Categorical variables were expressed as a number of patients and percentage of patients are compared across the group using Pearson chi-square test. Non-normal distribution continuous variables were compared using Mann-Whitney-U test. Now the result and discussion part will be taken over by Dr. Archana Thapa.
Thank you, Dr. Vaseem, and very good evening to my respected seniors and dear colleagues. Result: there was no statistical significance between the two groups with respect to the age, weight, height, sex, types of surgeries, and mean duration of surgeries. The difference in mean heart rate of the two groups was not statistically significant till intubation, but mean heart rate was lower in group D between 5 minutes till 60 minutes after intubation with p-value less than 0.05. Similarly, systolic blood pressure, diastolic blood pressure, and mean arterial pressure were significantly low in group D between 5 minutes till 60 minutes after intubation and was statistically significant with p-value less than 0.05. No significant difference in SpO2 between the study groups were seen. The mean BIS value was lower in group D between 5 minutes till 60 minutes after intubation and was statistically significant with p-value less than 0.05.
our study was performed to assess the depth of anesthesia with preoperative single dose of IV dexmedetomidine and IV fentanyl using BIS in patients undergoing elective surgeries under general anesthesia. The heart rate, systolic blood pressure, diastolic blood pressure, and mean arterial pressure was comparable between the groups at the starting of drug administration, 5 minutes, 10 minutes after starting of infusion, on shifting the patient to OT, at a time of induction before laryngoscopy, and just after intubation. Following intubation, heart rate was significantly low in group D as compared to group F until 60 minutes. Thus, dexmedetomidine effectively attenuated the increase in heart rate during these periods when compared to the fentanyl group with a statistically significant difference with p-value less than 0.05. These findings are consistent with the findings of Goyal et al. And Vaswani et al. Following intubation, the blood pressure values were significantly low in group D as compared to group F until the end of surgery. Thus, dexmedetomidine effectively attenuated the increase in systolic blood pressure, diastolic blood pressure, and mean arterial pressure during this period when compared to the fentanyl group with a statistically significant difference with p-value less than 0.05. Our findings are well matched with the observation by Goyal et al. And Zarinishin et al. Dexmedetomidine group showed that blood pressure decreases after the loading dose and stabilized thereafter during the intraoperative period to within 20% of the baseline values. There was also no significant increase in blood pressure in response to laryngoscopy and intubation in the dexmedetomidine group as compared to fentanyl group with oxygen saturation. There were no episodes of significant arterial oxygen desaturation to below 90%. This study showed a decrease in BIS values following infusion in both the groups. The difference was statistically significant 5 minutes after starting of infusion to 1 hour. The dexmedetomidine group achieved the target BIS value for general anesthesia faster than the fentanyl group. Our findings are similar to the observation reported by Goyal et al. And Thurgood et al. IV dexmedetomidine and fentanyl infusion was well tolerated amongst the patients in our study. We did not observe any case of apnea in both the groups. Take home message, the BIS value was decreased in both groups as compared to baseline values, but it was more decreased in group D as compared to group F. The dexmedetomidine group achieved the target BIS of general anesthesia faster than the fentanyl group. The hemodynamics starting from 5 minutes after initiation of infusion of study drugs to the completion of the surgery were significantly more stable in group D as compared to group F. The stress response at the time of induction with propofol were better attenuated with dexmedetomidine. Both dexmedetomidine and fentanyl infusion were well tolerated with respect to its systemic side effects. Hence, we can say that the use of BIS in patients undergoing general anesthesia is a useful tool in the anesthetic armamentarium. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Archana. I will repeat the conclusion by her that the use of BIS in patients undergoing general anesthesia is a very, very useful tool in the anesthetic armamentarium. And I will say that BIS is not that commonly used as it is available with all our newer workstations. Thank you, Dr. Archana. The next topic of our presentation is a less explored topic of segmental spinal. The expanding scope of regional anesthesia in current practice, a review. It will be presented by Dr. Rupal Tiwari, our final year DNB resident, and Dr. Anshul, final year DNB resident. Dr. Rupal, please.
Good evening, respected senior and my dear colleagues. I'm Dr. Rupal Tiwari, secondary DNB resident in Department of Anesthesiology, Deen Dayal Upadhyay Hospital, New Delhi. Today, our topic for discussion is segmental spinal, expanding scope of regional anesthesia in current practice. This topic will be moderated by Dr. Vatsala Agarwal, ma'am, head of the Department of Anesthesiology in Deen Dayal Upadhyay Hospital. Spinal anesthesia has been widely used in practice for decades, with excellent results for lower limb and abdominal surgeries. Segmental or thoracic spinal anesthesia, though introduced in 1909, was not used extensively due to the obvious complications. The apprehension of injuring the spinal cord led to the dormancy of segmental spinal anesthesia practice for a long time. There was a resurgence of studies and practice of segmental spinal after MRI study on the spine in different positions. Since then, the use and scope of surgeries being conducted under segmental spinal is ever increasing. To begin with, What is segmental spinal anesthesia? It is blocking of the required dermatomes essential for the proposed surgical procedure with a very low effective local anesthetic drug, often used synonymously with thoracic spinal anesthesia. The beginning of segmental spinal anesthesia was marked by Professor Thomas Jonesco in year 1909 when he coined the term general spinal analgesia. The article was published in British Medical Journal. In his study, he explained two sites of puncture: upper dorsal puncture between T1 to T2 for head, neck and upper limb surgeries. Second site, dorsolumbar puncture between T12 L1 for abdominal and lower limb surgeries. He quoted that, "I have total 1,015 spinal analgesia without a death and without any serious complications, either during analgesia or afterwards." He firmly convinced that general spinal analgesia will be the analgesic method of the future. Despite of this pioneering study by Thomas Jonesco, segmental spinal was not practiced extensively until the MRI study was done in 2010, following which the practice of segmental spinal became popular and is currently being used in upper abdominal surgery, both open and laparoscopic surgery such as cholecystectomy, and thoracic surgeries like breast surgeries with or without axillary node dissection. There are three variants of segmental spinal anesthesia. First is single shot segmental spinal for short to mid duration surgeries, in which we use single low dose of local anesthetic agent. And second variant is combined segmental spinal epidural for longer duration surgeries, in the single spinal dose is followed by epidural supplement in form of bolus or continuous infusion. Third variant is continuous segmental spinal anesthesia using spinocath intrathecally for extensive and long duration surgeries. The site and dose of local anesthetic depends on the type of surgery, either open or laparoscopic, site, thoracic or abdominal, and duration of surgery. It is also depends on variant of segmental spinal is being used: single shot, combined segmental spinal epidural, continuous segmental spinal anesthesia. The technique of administering segmental spinal anesthesia is very similar of giving the traditional spinal anesthesia. It can be given in sitting position and lateral position. Usual bony landmark used for identification of thoracic segments are tip of scapula corresponds to T7 vertebrae and highest point of iliac crest correspond to L3, L4 interspace. The only difference between traditional spinal and segmental spinal is spinal needle needs to be angulated at 40 to 45 degree in order to accommodate for angulation of thoracic spinous process. Multiple drugs have been used for this, which includes 0.5% bupivacaine, 0.5% levobupivacaine, 0.75% ropivacaine, 1% chlorpromazine. Hyperbaric bupivacaine can be used where gravity dependence is desired, such as unilateral breast surgeries. Adjuvants can be added like fentanyl, morphine, clonidine, and dexmedetomidine. Various studies have been conducted on segmental spinal over the years. As we can see in most of the studies, the puncture site is either T9, T10, T5 to T6. Only fine gauge needle or CAC kit have been used in either sitting position or lateral decubitus position. The most commonly drug used is 0.5% bupivacaine, isobaric or hyperbaric, doses of 1 to 2 ml. With or without adjuvants. Adjuvants like fentanyl, sufentanil, morphine. Regarding the position of the patient, the study was conducted in 2010 by Lee et al. On the anatomy of thoracic spinal canal in different positions using MRI, revealed that the distance between dura and spinal cord was more in lateral position and sitting position than supine position. Distance was found to be maximum in sitting position at T6 level, that is 5.95 millimeter, which makes the sitting position most preferable. While administering segmental spinal, both Quinkies and pencil point needle can be used. Using a CAC kit is the safest. A study conducted by M. Belloni et al. on the incidence of paresthesia and neurological complications comparing the cut needle and pencil point needle on 300 patients reveal no statistically significant difference between the two. However, pencil point needle has a dead space distal to its hole in the needle, which may cause trauma to the spine. So the cut needle is most commonly used. The further discussion will be taken up by my dear colleague, Dr. Anshul Srivastava. Thank you.
Good evening, respected seniors and dear colleagues. Most of the clinicians, while administering segmental spinal anesthesia, are scared of three major concerns. The first, neurological injury, because the prick is being taken above the L1 level. Second, ventilatory impairment due to the respiratory muscle paralysis. And third, high spinal leading to hypotension and bradycardia. We will be addressing each one separately. The risk of neurological injury is minimal, as the MRI revealed that the spinal cord lies more anteriorly in the thoracic region, while the cord and cauda equina touch the posterior dura at lumbar levels. In lateral and sitting position, the distance between dura and spinal cord is widest. Hence, it is safe to puncture dura at thoracic levels. The safety of dura puncture at thoracic level is further proven by low rates of neurological injuries after accidental dura puncture during thoracic epidural placement. There is a natural thoracic kyphosis from T5 to T7, because of which the volume of CSF at thoracic level is less. Also, thoracic nerve roots are thin and can efficiently be blockaded with even the small amounts of local anesthetic drug. The MRI of the spine showed that the distance between dura and spinal cord at T2, T5 and T10 level is 4.19, 6.17 and 4.71 millimeters respectively. Taking the angle of entry as 45 degrees, this distance is effectively increased to 5.19 at T2, 7.75 at T5 and 5.88 mm at T10, hence making the thoracic puncture even more safer. Coming to the second concern, effect on ventilation, as we all know, diaphragm is the main muscle for respiration, which is supplied by phrenic nerve. The root value for phrenic nerve is C3, C4 and C5 and so usually not affected, as low dose is used and only segmental block is achieved. Use of low dose also preserves cuffing and predominantly a sensory block is achieved. The third concern, high spinal, may decrease heart rate due to the blockade of cardioaccelerator fibers from T1 to T4. But in segmental spinal, lumbosacral sparing occurs, due to which there is less venodilatation in lower limbs and right atrial filling is maintained, because of which there is less hypotension and sustained outflow from intrinsic chronotropic receptors is there, and hence heart rate and cardiac output are maintained. So the question remains, why segmental spinal over general anesthesia? First of all, it avoids all the complications related to general anesthesia, be it airway trauma, airway edema, hoarseness of voice, sore throat, or any complication or side effects of drugs used in general anesthesia. A very low dose of local anesthetic is required for segmental spinal. The cost of giving a segmental spinal is very low. The hemodynamic fluctuations are minimal, and hence it can be used in hemodynamically unstable patients. Segmental spinal offers early recovery, early voiding, less post-operative nausea and vomiting, especially is preferred in patients with respiratory comorbidities. It can decrease the post-op pulmonary complications, and there is less requirement of ventilatory support. Coming to the limitations of segmental spinal, it is said that it is reserved for experienced and skilled anesthesiologist. USG guidance is preferable for more safety. Laparoscopic surgeries under segmental spinal may need some more sedation, and use of fine gauge needle, that is 27 gauge, is recommended. As we can see, all these limitations can easily be overcome. I would like to now discuss a few studies which were groundbreaking in the field of segmental spinal. The first study I would like to discuss is from British Journal of Anesthesia in 2006. Van Zundert conducted this study in segmental spinal for open cholecystectomy in a patient with severe lung disease. In his study, he said that there is never a right way to anesthetize such a patient, but segmental spinal expands the boundaries of regional anesthesia and is advantageous in certain patients. Following which, He used similar technique in 30 patients and got excellent results with no untoward effect. Following which, he again conducted a study in 2007, which was published in British Journal of Anesthesia. But this time, the surgery was laparoscopic cholecystectomy under segmental thoracic spinal. In this study, 20 patients were taken. Only 6 experienced some discomfort, which was readily treated with small doses of fentanyl, but none of them required conversion to general anesthesia. The author concluded that segmental spinal can successfully and effectively be used for laparoscopic surgery in healthy patients. The study conducted by Mohammed Hamdi in 2013 compared segmental thoracic spinal and general anesthesia for breast cancer surgery. Intraoperative hypertension, hypotension, bradycardia, and postoperative nausea vomiting were compared. It was concluded that segmental thoracic spinal has advantages when compared with general anesthesia and can be considered as a sole anesthetic in breast cancer surgery with axillary lymph node clearance. A review done in 2018 over thoracic spinal anesthesia, which included 16 related articles, concluded that thoracic spinal anesthesia carries many benefits and it should be considered for high-risk patients who cannot tolerate general anesthesia due to associated comorbidities. The author also quoted that thoracic spinal anesthesia should be given to the right patient by the right physician. A systematic review in 2020 was done, including 30 studies regarding segmental spinal anesthesia. In this study, it was concluded that segmental spinal is one of the most popular and widely used anesthetic procedures. It is simple, cost-effective, and an efficient technique that provides complete sensory and motor block as well as post-operative analgesia with a high success rate. It was also concluded that the thoracic puncture, which is performed in segmental spinal anesthesia, is safe and so far without neurological damage. So to sum up, segmental spinal anesthesia can be a very useful technique with many advantages. It carries minimal risk with due precautions. Recent studies have shown the safety and efficacy of the procedure and is currently being practiced worldwide with promising results. Its use has seen a drastic resurgence in the last decade and has shown that it can safely be used for most of the upper abdominal surgeries and thoracic surgeries. To further enhance its effects, it can be used in adjunct to regional blocks for better post-op analgesia. Example, epidural, PEC-1 and PEC-2 blocks, serratus anterior plane block, or for breast surgeries, transverse abdominis plane block, rectus sheath block, erector spinal block for abdominal surgeries, and intraperitoneal local anesthetic instillation for abdominal surgeries. Thank you.
To conclude, I believe that segmental anesthesia will play a very important role in upper abdominal and thoracic surgeries, especially in these COVID times where regional anesthesia is preferred over general anesthesia. Our next presentation will be the role of central venous catheter line in ICU, which is a very debatable topic at present. Dr. Utkarshni will be telling us all the advantages of central line in ICU, whereas Dr. Akhila will be speaking against it. So, central line in ICU, is it a boon or bane? Dr. Utkarshni, please.
Good evening to all the seniors and my fellow colleagues. Today, we'll discuss the role of central line in ICU, whether it is a boon or a bane. Presenters are Dr. Utkarshni Kedia, Dr. Akhila, moderated by Dr. Vatsala Agarwal, HOD Anesthesia, DDU Hospital. A central venous catheter is an intravenous device that is inserted into a vein in the neck, chest, or groin. It was described by Dr. Obinak in 1952, where he cannulated the SVC in the battlefield to resuscitate the wounded soldiers. It was such an invention that in 1956, Cornard, Frostman, and Richards won Nobel Prize for the concept of central venous access. About 8% of hospitalized patients require central line. The common sites for central venous catheter insertion are internal jugular vein, subclavian vein, axillary vein, basilic vein, cephalic vein, superior vena cava, right and left inordinate vein. Now, the indications for central venous catheterizations are to provide caustic medications and solution which may cause phlebitis and sclerosis if given through peripheral line like inotropic agents, long-term intravenous treatment like chemotherapy and antibiotics for total parenteral nutrition, for difficult peripheral access, like in a case of a burn, amputated patient, hypovolemic shock, for placement of other devices like pacing wire, pulmonary artery catheter, IVC filters and stents, for hemofiltration, hemodialysis and plasmapheresis, for measurement of the central venous pressure, monitoring of the mixed venous or jugular bulb oxygen saturation, replacing of circulatory volume and rapid infusion of fluid, like in a case of a trauma or a major surgery, for aspiration of an air emboli, which may occur in a neurosurgery case, and for repeated blood sampling. A central venous pressure is the pressure measured in the large central vein close to the right atrium, which indicates the mean right atrial pressure, frequently used as an estimate of the right ventricular preload. The normal CVP value is 0 to 8 centimeters of water. The purpose of measuring central venous pressure is to assess patient's fluid volume status, to assess the preload of the heart. An invasive hemodynamic monitoring helps for early detection, identification, and treatment of life-threatening conditions like heart failure, which non-invasive method take longer time to detect or fail to detect. It helps to evaluate patient's response to therapy and provides information about the right ventricular function and allows for evaluation of right-sided heart hemodynamics. For measurement of CVP, the tip of the central line catheter lies at the junction of the vena cava and the right atrium. The pressure at the end of diastole reflects back to the catheter. When connected to the manometer or a transducer, the catheter measures CVP, an index of right ventricular function. The reference point for zeroing is the intersection of the fourth intercostal space and mid-axillary line in supine position, which corresponds to the level of atria. Now, the role of CVP as a hemodynamic variable is CVP is a determinant of the venous return, which is defined as the mean filling pressure minus the central venous pressure by the venous resistance. CVP also influences the blood capillary flow, which depends on the gradient between the mean arterial pressure and the CVP. A high CVP value is always pathological, regardless of the cause. Always considered as an alarm signal should trigger an urgent diagnostic assessment aimed to determine the underlying cause. CVP establishes a limit for fluid administration. So the role of CVP for guiding fluid therapy is not for defining how much, but rather when to stop giving fluids. Now, I do agree that central line comes with various complications, but there are ways to prevent it. Like prefer peripheral lines over a central line, use antimicrobial impregnated catheters, strict asepsis at insertion, removing catheter when no longer required, recognize risk factor for difficult catheterization and seek experienced assistance, avoid femoral route, use ultrasound for catheter insertion, which has decreased the complication from 11.8 to 4%. Always confirm the position using chest X-ray post-procedure. After 3 to 4 tries, let someone else try. If attempt at one site fails, try new site on the same site to avoid bilateral complications. Halt positive pressure ventilation as the needle penetrates the chest wall. If resistance is felt while inserting the guide wire, withdraw slightly and rotate the wire and re-advance. Now, the use of central line in COVID pandemic is peripheral venous access may not be available. Long-term ICU stay for COVID patients. They may need inotropic support and irritant drugs. Patients might go into shock. TPN might be required and daily sampling and hence a daily prick may be avoided. Now I'll hand over the screen to Dr. Akhila to share her views on central line.
Thank you. Good evening, seniors and fellow colleagues. Dr. Utkarshini, according to her points, we feel that central line has to be placed in all the patients admitted in ICU. But the question I like to raise is whether central line is mandatory for all these patients in the ICU. So this is a tendency followed in most of the ICUs as central line is thought to be a reliable hemodynamic variable for deciding fluid administration. But numerous trials have shown that central venous pressure isn't a reliable index for predicting fluid responsiveness, as there are a lot of factors affecting the measured CVP, like a central venous blood volume, compliance of central compartment, the tricuspid valve disease, cardiac rhythm abnormalities, reference level of transducer, and intrathoracic pressure. Moreover, Central venous pressure as a hemodynamic variable cannot predict cardiac preload as it is affected by transmural pressure, end-diastolic volume, and the interaction between right ventricular function and venous return. Also, CVP cannot predict the volume responsiveness of patient, as whether the cardiac output will increase after fluid administration cannot be predicted, as cardiac output depends also on ventricular function. CVP cannot measure circulatory filling, as CVP is affected by vascular tone, and peripheral venoconstriction or vasodilation can give a false high or raised CVP. So CVP always comes with limitations, as it cannot predict preload, it cannot measure cardiac output, it cannot predict the status of pulmonary circulation in case of a left ventricular dysfunction, it cannot measure circulatory filling, and an isolated CVP reading is of limited use, and a trend of reading has to be reviewed with other parameters of hemodynamic variable. And CVP monitor doesn't actually show the exact value, and a manometer reading can cause subjective errors. So CVP comes with a lot of complication, which can be immediate and delayed. Immediate complications need early recognition, as they are life-threatening and even more detrimental than the underlying condition. Operator expertise is needed for successful placement of the line. An immediate complication can be vascular, cardiac, and pulmonary. Vascular complications include arterial injury, which is usually recognized by a spurt of bright red blood. But what if the patient is hypotensive and critically ill patient? In case it is not recognized, an arterial placement can lead to thrombosis, which lead to neurodeficit and stroke. Uncontrolled hemorrhage is also another complication, which can lead to shock and cardiac arrest. Venous injury can lead to bleeding and hematoma, and the incidence is 4.7%. The main reason is the guide wire is getting trapped against the wall, causing linear laceration. And laceration can occur in grazed vessels like vena cava, mediastinal vessel, and right atrium. Bleeding occurring in subclavian vessel is uncontrollable, as it is surrounded by a lot of bony prominences. Anatomical variation can occur in many cases. Congenital variation and acquired variation are the reason for anatomical variation. And 0.3% of population can have aberrant left superior vena cava, which can cause embolic event and arrhythmia if it drains into left atrium. And acquired variation can occur in previously placed central line. Pulmonary complications include pneumothorax, pneumomediastinum, chylothorax, and also nerve injury like a recurrent laryngeal nerve injury and phrenic nerve injury. Cardiac complications are arrhythmia due to the placement of catheter in the atrium causing myocardial irritation, and injury can lead to tamponade and pericardial effusion that may cause cardiac arrest. Delayed complications include device dysfunction. After a week of placement of a catheter, a fibrin sheath can be formed around it and the aspiration of blood becomes difficult. Catheter fracture can lead to embolization, sepsis, and cardiac perforation. And thrombosis can lead to erythema, edema, and paresthesia of the limbs, and also superior vena cava syndrome. Stenosis is another complication. Infection is another significant complication, as it can lead to sepsis, shock, and death. And the mortality is as high as 25% in the patients. The causes of infection are skin flora contamination if asepsis is not followed, infusion of contaminated medications or IV fluids, hematogenous spread from another site. So in case a patient is having a urinary catheter or an abdominal tube, do we actually need another source of infection? Lack of advanced technologies like ultrasound, cardiopulmonary bypass, and interventional radiology suite in many institutes adds to the problem to tackle the complications. So to sum up, 15% of the patients have complications, and we can see that infection is 8.6% in an IJV placement and as high as 15.3% in a femoral venous catheterization. And thrombosis and arterial puncture, the chances are high in a femoral venous catheterization. In case of COVID pandemic, I feel that central line is invasive. More exposure to aerosol occurs, as it is a time-consuming procedure, and the chances of injuring an already compromised lung is more. Also, it is cumbersome because our staffs are equipped with a PPE and the vision is also compromised. So the chances of error are more. The alternatives for hemodynamic monitoring include the standard monitors, assessing the kidney function, electrical bioimpedance, thoracic bioreactants, and non-invasive cardiac output monitoring. The minimally invasive monitoring system include transesophageal echocardiography and esophageal Doppler. So I feel in an ICU, there should be a judicious use of central line. And before we place a central line, we always have to stop, think, observe, and proceed. Thank you.
So to conclude, I will say that central line, although very essential, has its own set of complications. So it should not be mandatory to be put in every patient who is admitted in ICU because of the risks which are involved. But if the intensivist feels at that time that it is essential and it can help us in managing the patient for patient betterment, then we can definitely put it in. So always weigh the risk and benefits before putting a central line. The concept of this last topic came up as one of our senior resident, Dr. Ravi Kishore, got infected with this disease while doing his COVID duties in COVID ICU in October 2020. I was called up by one of my senior residents on duty with him that Dr. Ravi had breathing difficulty and his X-ray chest has revealed bilateral ground glass opacities. His heart rate had climbed up from 90 per minute to 130 per minute and he was very anxious to the extent that he informed them not to tell his wife because she also was on COVID duties in COVID ICU in Apollo Hospital. On his request, he was shifted to another higher center on HFNO at 4 a.m. in the morning. This dreadful situation prompted me to conduct a specific study on psychological, social, and economic impact of this disease on the affected doctors. Dr. Ravi Kishore will himself give us a briefing about his experience, and this descriptive study will be presented by Dr. Deepthi, our second year DNP student. Dr. Deepthi, please.
Good evening, respected seniors and my dear colleagues. My name is Dr. Deepthi Dilip. I am a second year primary DNP resident in the Department of Anesthesiology at Deen Dayal Upadhyay Hospital, New Delhi. I am here to present my study on the impact of COVID-19 on doctors affected by it. The study was designed by Dr. Vatsala Agarwal, Madam, HOD Anesthesiology at Deen Dayal Upadhyay Hospital, Dr. Anshul Srivastava, and Dr. Deepthi Dilip. The novel coronavirus, also termed as SARS-CoV-2, was initially discovered in November 2019 in Wuhan, China. The associated human disease, COVID-19, was declared a global pandemic in March 2020. Worldwide, this disease has affected 90 million people, with 10 million of them being in India itself. It has also resulted in the loss of 1.8 million lives and more than 150,000 people in India itself. Among the affected, 50 million of individuals have recovered worldwide. A new variant strain has been detected in almost 50 countries and the counts are still rising. This is a picture of Dr. Li Wenliang, an ophthalmologist based in Wuhan, who was the first doctor to alert the world about the spread of this killer virus way back in 2019. Unfortunately, he contracted the disease and succumbed to the disease in February 2020. This pandemic and the consequent lockdown has affected the social, psychological, economic, and educational aspects of human life and behavior unprecedentedly. But it cannot be denied that the maximum effect has been faced by the healthcare workers. Statistically, this disease has affected 300,000 healthcare workers globally and has resulted in the death of 7,000 of our healthcare workers. The picture in India is similarly bleak. As of August 2020, more than 87,000 healthcare workers have been affected, and it has resulted in the death of more than 573 healthcare workers. This is a brief video wherein Dr. Ravi Kishore, one of the secondary DNB residents at our hospital, explains or shares with us his experience of having been infected with COVID-19.
Good morning, respected seniors and colleagues. I am Dr. Ravi Kishore, second DNB resident at DDU Hospital, New Delhi. I am here today to share my experience of being infected with COVID-19. I was posted in the ICU managing COVID positive patients in October 2020. I had come to for the night duty at the ICU. I remember coming to the duty as usual. Nothing was out of ordinary. I took over along with my colleagues and went about my duty. I took my rounds as usual at around 4 a.m. My colleague suggested getting a cup of coffee to recharge. I doffed and I went to DDR to take a break. As I sat down, my colleague asked me if I was feeling all right. Confused, I asked him why. He replied that you seem to be breathing heavily. Immediately he checked my oxygen saturation. I was surprised to find that it was 90%. I was feeling completely fine until then. My general medicine colleague was called to have a look. After examining me, he said that I had bilateral Coase Krebs. I was immediately taken to the X-ray room. My chest X-ray revealed bilateral opacities. Rapid antigen test confirmed my worst fears. I remember slightly feeling anxious at that point. I was in a place far away from my home, working in the front line, and seemed to have caught COVID. Although I know what I had signed up for when I joined this profession, being at the receiving end of such a diagnosis did scare me. The rest of the duty seemed like a blur. I was immediately put on a high flow oxygen therapy. My consultant in charge arrived promptly, reassured me, and started making arrangements to shift me to the higher center for further management. I spent 8 days at the center. I was treated with antibiotics, injection Clexane, injection Remdesivir, routine vitamin supplements, and was eventually COVID free. After making a complete recovery, I joined back and have been doing regular COVID duties ever since.
This was the experience of one of our colleagues who suffered from COVID-19 in the line of duty. It was this incident that prompted us to undertake a study to identify the social, work-related, and psychological impact of this disease on the doctors who were affected by this. The study was done to evaluate the consequence of COVID-19 infection on the doctors in the front line. In a developing country like India, with a patient-to-doctor ratio of 1,445:1, which is lower than the WHO recommended ratio of 1,000:1, these consequences can have long-lasting impacts. How we went about the study was a questionnaire containing 21 questions, subdivided into personal impact, social impact, economical impact, and work-related impact was made and sent via social media to the doctors who had been affected by it. Their responses were then evaluated. Aim was to make a descriptive study on the impact of COVID-19 disease on the doctors infected in their line of duty. Out of the 49 doctors who responded, 73% said that they got tested because they were symptomatic. 7% of doctors said that they suffered from a severe form of the disease which required hospitalization with oxygen support, plasma therapy, steroids, antibiotics, etc. 15% said that they required hospitalization of 7 to 14 days. Among the respondents, 69% felt frustrated with the public's attitude towards the pandemic. Shockingly, 53% of doctors responded that they had faced some form of social stigma being a healthcare worker in the present scenario. This is a screen grab from one of the news reports, which shows the incident that happened at Indore. Two doctors were assaulted by a mob when they went to check on a patient who had been infected with COVID-19. Most of the doctors with comorbidities replied that they would be willing to provide their services even if given the choice of opting out. Along a similar note, majority, that is 64%, replied that in light of the new strain, they would go through the entire cycle again if necessary. A large chunk of the respondents felt guilty about the risk that they are putting their family in due to the nature of their work. Economic impact.
76% of doctors have had to pay the treatment expenses themselves. But on a happier note, 72% were given paid leaves on their days missed while they were recovering. It is sad to note that 10% faced unemployment even during this pandemic. Most of the doctors, that is 76%, replied that they find their work tiring. 31% felt that they are not able to give their optimum input in these circumstances. A significant portion, that is 40%, have replied that they are not getting adequate PPE, and 79% feel that their hospitals could have taken further measures to prevent their infection. Right from their training period, doctors are told time and again that their profession is one of the toughest ones out there. We are told to grit our teeth and face it head on. Hence, we know that doctors are more prone to anxiety and stress compared to the general population. Add to this a pandemic which requires social isolation, increases the work hours as well as the patient load, along with the callous attitude the public has displayed recently. It is no wonder that the stress levels amongst doctors has skyrocketed. This will eventually lead to burnout, which is characterized by emotional exhaustion, cynicism, depersonalization, and a decreased sense of personal accomplishments. On the long run, all of these can have detrimental effects on the level of care that we can afford. So what do we do to overcome this? Regular psychological screening of all the doctors who are directly involved in the diagnosis as well as the management of patients affected with COVID-19 should be done so that stress, anxiety, depression amongst doctors can be caught earlier on and they can get the treatment that they deserve. We can advocate the practice of stress-reducing exercises like yoga, mindfulness, and deep breathing exercises on the doctors. Many individuals do not know how to communicate their feelings adequately. Workshops can be conducted to improve their communication skills so that they may better tell us what they need and so that they can avail the right therapy. Social aspects of the pandemic on affected doctors. Despite working around the clock to keep the pandemic at bay, the attitude of the general public towards the doctors has been less than satisfactory. There have been multiple instances of misbehavior towards doctors, such as the incident that happened at Indore, the instance where resident doctors were harassed by the general public, multiple instances where doctors were evicted from their homes by the landlords. From our study, it was noted that despite facing so many adversities and having suffered from the infection themselves, our doctors are willing to come back and give their services all over again. Although a number of doctors were infected with COVID-19 in our institute, thankfully, we did not lose any of our colleagues. Sadly, the same cannot be said about frontline doctors everywhere. This is the picture of Dr. Simon Hercules, a neurosurgeon based in Chennai. He contracted the disease and eventually succumbed to it in April 2020. The sad part of it was he was not afforded a proper burial by the local mob. His colleagues had to give him a rushed burial in the middle of the night due to this. How to mitigate this? Support from healthcare authorities, regulators, and the government for doctors making difficult clinical decisions is vital, as is the understanding that they will be supported in the event of adverse outcomes. Similarly, the administration should provide adequate security to the doctors who are doing groundwork in these times. The government's efforts, like giving paid leave to the doctors who are recuperating and avoiding extension of their tenures, need to be commended at this stage. On a similar vein, the government's efforts in preventing the eviction of doctors from rental housing was much needed relief for healthcare workers. Coming to the economic impact of this disease, many private hospitals have cut down on the salaries of or laid off doctors to compensate for the decrease in revenue during this pandemic. Similarly, many small clinics have been shut down in the light of the events of the past year. For many doctors who are just starting out, this has been a huge blow. It was indeed shocking to know that the country's apex court had to intervene
to ensure that doctors and healthcare workers were paid their salaries without any dues. One of the major limitations of the study was the sample size. We were able to get only 49 responses, and hence further studies may be needed to get a better picture about the impact of this disease on affected doctors. The other limitation we faced was the time constraint. The lacunae of the study was, we were able to find a few studies on the impact of COVID-19 on healthcare workers as a whole. But to the best of our knowledge, this is the first study that evaluates the impact of this disease on doctors infected with COVID-19. It is evident from the information gathered that such an unprecedented time has had a significant impact on the mental, physical, and emotional well-being of our healthcare workers who have had to work tirelessly for almost a year in the front lines. With the approval of Covishield and Covaxin, we are seeing a light at the end of the tunnel, but we cannot expect everything to go back to normal all at once. Thank you.
It is heartening to see that the fear factor of COVID disease for our doctors like Dr. Ravi Kishore has been relieved by the launch of the COVID vaccine drive in our country with effect from 16th January 2021. Now all the four sessions are open for discussion. You can type your questions in the chat box and they will be answered one by one by our speaker.
It seems there are no questions in the chat box. So
all the presentations were very clear and self-explanatory, and very nicely presented, Dr. Vatsala. Congratulations to you and your team. And the last presentation was the last study that you're doing or have done is really commendable, and of course kudos to all our corona warriors.
Yes, it is all because of their effort that we were able to do this and manage that also.
Yes.
So I would like you to conclude the session, ma'am, now.
Yes, please.
So thank you everyone for joining us in this program and being a participant in our scientific program. Thank you, Dr. Nikki. And I hope this year will be a far better year, as you've said earlier. And thank you all the students, the faculty members, Dr. Ritu, Dr. Bhavna, Dr. Aparajita, Dr. Dipali, who have helped me behind the screens. And thank you to Mr. Raghu, who has been the backbone. And thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you, Dr. Vatsala. Thank you. Have a very good evening.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. We conclude the meeting now?
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Okay, ma'am.